Good evening, everybody, and welcome to episode 4 of PAPAtv Live. We are here right outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in Carnegie, and we have 3 games for you tonight. I'm here joined in the studio right now with Mark Steinman and Fred Cochran. And first things first, we want to talk about a couple things. We don't get to highlight this enough, but first, the circuit standings. Number one is Keith Elwin. He has 252 points and 1 win. Zach Sharp is number 2 with 210 points. Jorian Engelbrechtsen is 3rd with 205 points. Kaylee has 175 points in 4th. And Robert Gagneau is in 5th right now with 172 points. Hey, Fred, why don't you give us the current standings of how we're doing with the Player of the Month competition for the IFPA.
Alrighty. Number one is Trent Augenstein from Delaware, Ohio, 52.88 points.
No shocker there.
No, not at all. Frank Romero from New York, he's 2nd place, 39.26. Adam McKinney from Missouri, 35.92. Dave Heggie from Chicago, 33.7. And Sean Grant, the Storm, 33.56, rounding out your top five.
We should mention that those standings are through today. So there's still a chance to get out there and become Player of the Month or get into the circuit.
So I'm already looking at the chat here, and I see you guys are talking about something we were talking about before the broadcast.
Mr. Dew's Wild Ride?
Well, that's not the only thing. We were actually talking about Farsight Studios. They released Dracula today, and the big news is actually that they're having a Kickstarter in order to get the rights so they can do the Addams Family. And that Kickstarter is, they're looking for $100,001 in order to do that Kickstarter. I'm trying to figure out where the $1 came from.
I'm trying to figure out why it was 50 grand more than their Twilight Zone Kickstarter.
I'm sure there's a lot of rights involved with something like that. Oh. I mean,
That's a lot of dough. That's a lot of dough for a virtual game.
And that's not all.
Good luck for them.
Other news of the week. The Stern factory is moving.
To the Papa warehouse?
I didn't know that. Where are they headed?
They're staying in Illinois, but they have a bigger facility lined up. And nobody really knows exactly why, but my guess is that it has something to do with the manufacturers of, like, the planetary pinball stuff.
My guess is that things are doing pretty well.
Yep. Third thing, the Fraser Valley Circuit event. It's at the end of this month. Where's that at, Mark?
It's up in Abbotsford. It's in Canada in the Great Northwest. We encourage anyone to come up and get a chance to try your hand with some of the best players. And I'm really looking forward to it. It looks like a real fun place, and you can find information online. Just search for the Fraser Valley Flipout. We should have links to it at PAPA.org as well.
Mark, last week I made a mistake. I forgot to ask you a question that you were supposed to explain.
You only made one mistake last week?
That's the only mistake I'm admitting to.
he's very humble, isn't he?
Just like to know you all to know out there, I'm not perfect. Occasionally, I make a mistake. This was my first mistake ever on any of these broadcasts.
Fred Cochran is also not perfect.
I'm a mistake just in general, I was told.
What happened, John?
So there was a question out there that we said you were going to answer last week, and that was to explain why the pop-up format is single player when you're actually qualifying, and why it's multiplayer when you're playing in the finals.
Oh, I do remember discussing that. So I've been involved with PAPA for about 4 years now. Obviously, we're at PAPA 18, so I haven't been around the whole way through. To the best of my knowledge, the format changes for 2 reasons. One is to challenge players in just a different way. It can be, whenever you're playing to qualify single player, it's you against the machine, and you employ different strategies. And then whenever you're playing match play against someone head-to-head in the finals, sometimes you got to handle the same situation differently, so challenging players. And the second reason is tradition. I believe that's how it's always been done, and it's something that's carried over through the years, and tradition's a big part of an organization like this, so we keep it that way.
Well, that's a good answer. And finally, our final order of business, and then I promise you we're going to move on to the games. That's Chicago Expo. That's going to be our next broadcast. Well, actually, we might do 2 more weeks of this.
We should mention, actually, sorry, before we jump in, we're not doing Elvira tonight. We were going to line up Elvira and the Party Monsters, but it exploded, so we have to do Space Station. We wheeled that in instead.
One of the Party Monsters got up and left. Yeah. And the left flipper. It caught on fire.
Thank you, boys.
Thank you. So, we have a real treat tonight. We're going to have Greg Galanter play Revenge from Mars.
He's looking dapper for pinball, too. Look at him. He's the best-dressed pinball player that I've seen in some time.
That's because we have him actually in an isolation booth right now. we found out that he contracted the Black Death, and so we had to lock him in an isolation booth. Actually,
at least he didn't get dysentery like Eitan did in Louisville.
When Mark switches to it, we're going to notice that there's like we have a drape over the top of the machine.
It's a little hidden, actually. We angled the camera just so you couldn't see it, but putting together a Revenge from Mars for a live broadcast was not easy. Anyone who's ever seen this game knows that it's a little bit different of a shape, and it's not the easiest. It's not the most standard cabinet.
We have actually a question on the chat. They say they want to see how the camera setup is for this. So,
do you think
we can make that happen at some point? We don't have to do that right away, but
I'll pan out in a little bit.
I was gonna say there's one if you can see the camera right in front of Greg. There's one right in front of the lock bar where his hand is.
That's in between his flippers, just so you know.
Yeah, so he's standing behind that, so he has to be mindful of that. And there is actually a camera right above his head when he gets into his playing stance.
Well, Greg, why don't you go ahead and fire it up for us a while? And good grief, that guy in the back glass, who is that?
I think that's Joe Dillon. That's who the game was dedicated to.
Okay. Oh, has great music.
Time to unmute Greg and get this thing going.
Greg, you need to do Mars Needs Women. Oh, you didn't do
it. Me.
That's okay.
Paris in Peril. So, when you're walking up to Revenge from Mars the first time, what's your first thoughts, Mark?
If I'm playing this in a tournament, I'm probably going to be boring and just shoot multi-balls over and over and over and over. I'm sure there's a more effective strategy out there, or someone may know a more effective strategy, but I don't, so that's pretty much how I would simplify it.
Yeah, you played a game with me before we went on, Mark, and you definitely don't know how to play this game.
Okay,
there's no doubt about it.
Once again, I'd like to say thank God that I'm in the booth.
Yeah, I'm not a real big fan of this game either. So the right people are behind the microphone right now.
Basically, you're going to get to choose your mode whenever you walk up to the game. So there's 9 modes, which are, you can see the inserts for, located in between the slingshots and slightly above. And once you complete a set of those 3, you get to go do a bonus wave. And then you can get the bonus wave multi-ball if during that you complete enough stuff. That's
a very succinct and to the point description, John. Very nicely done.
Wow, I just really I completely zoned out right during the end of that, and I'm like, stuff.
So there's 9. So there's 9 different modes, and if you complete each set of 3, you enter a bonus wave, and if you complete the bonus wave, you get a multi-ball. Yeah, is that what I'm understanding?
Yeah, each mode consists of 6 shots where it'll finish the mode. There's the Martians or the women or whatever. There's lit up red shots around the playfield, and as you complete them, you can get a perfect score. Towards a bonus later in the game when you get the mothership.
Greg, why did you start with the mode you did?
Because the game selected it for me. It counted down. I was
trying to tell you to do Mars Needs Women, but you weren't paying attention.
I wasn't paying attention.
That's okay, Greg.
I couldn't actually hear you. I had to readjust my headphones.
Of course, the likely excuse.
Actually, I think he was just strategically ignoring us, which might be much smarter in the long run anyways.
Actually, I think he might have been fixing his belt.
You are looking very good today, Greg.
Thank you very much.
He is looking dapper. So he just finished the mode here. He got, let's see how many he's got.
I did not do it flawlessly.
You didn't do flawless. You got 2 out of 4, which stinks. So
that really stinks.
Now you got to get the giant rooster and the big egg.
Right. And Roy Wills just pointed out that every flawless completion of a mission earns you a saucer light. And I'm starting to recall those now. And if you earn enough of those...
Yes.
You get to do something really cool. It's like stuff, but really cool.
Cool stuff lights.
I really did used to understand completely how to play this game, but it's been a while.
I think you need to head over to Tomka's house later on and play it.
I don't think he does.
Oh, he still has it.
He'll tell you he has the whole internet connection as well, too. So
this game was noteworthy for being the first Pinball 2000 game. And this was, what, the second to last game before Williams closed, I believe. They followed this up with Star Wars Episode One, and then things didn't work out so hot after that.
Pinball 2000, that's just such a interesting thing because it has a lot of positives associated with it.
All right, you want me to
and
do
negatives.
Yeah, there you go. Mars Needs Women. Those are the funny ones, provided you make the shots, of course.
Greg, Fred is not interested in any skillful play. He just wants to hear fun sound effects.
Well, let's.
You seem to enjoy them earlier, Mark.
All right, let's be quiet and listen.
I winked at her.
You winked at her?
Well, I'm the Martian in that scene.
Do you have like seven eyes? Here
I
we
think
go.
I just have two eyes.
You need to.
The first time I played this game, I couldn't play it because I was laughing the entire time I was playing it.
I'm telling you, the best one is the produce department. Come on, get the produce department, Greg. Let's see if he can make it here. Hit the TV. Oh, he's going for the easy shots here. Oh, Muscle Beach.
No, actually, I want to get the four on the side out of the way first so I don't accidentally complete it.
Oh. Well, that's right. You want perfection. I get
it. So you're going for that saucer light.
I am.
Okay.
Ooh, nice little tip pass.
Why? You know, I'm just wondering, why does Mars need women?
Really? You're actually asking this question?
You just dropped on a couple pegs, John.
No, right? We don't even need to talk about this. It's self-evident. If you don't know, then don't even worry about it.
John, you just dug yourself in there. Here we go. Clean up and broccoli.
Oh, my gosh.
That's the best one.
Clean up and produce.
Yeah, because if you hear it, it says clean up and produce after that comes out of the broccoli. Whoop.
Humor is an underrated.
That's the greatest thing on
pinball.
That game. By far. Oh, come on, Greg. Hit it harder, Greg.
So after he completes the mode, one shot to the center here finishes it out.
Yeah, or that.
It's actually a little hard to tell, but there's actually, just because of the holographic effect that it has, but there's a ramp that comes up out of the middle of the playfield, and that's how you actually complete the modes, is by jumping it into that ramp.
It's not the easiest shot. It seems
like it's
very simple.
Well, you also have to jump it into the target or whatever's in the back that's going to register it.
Yes.
Crazy Bob's a little shout out to Johnny Mnemonic, I believe.
Is that Inspector Gadget?
Yeah.
Oh.
And remember, people in the chat, while we're going along, if you have a question about how this game works, we might not be able to answer, but we can have Greg shoot at something, or we can, you know, we can find out how to answer it anyways.
I can't believe you just broke the monitor on TV. Way to go, Greg.
Two more for the bonus wave.
Right, so this is, what is this, the second one? So
Paris.
This is the one I shoot it, and then they drop some Martians down, I shoot the Martians.
So, Fred, between Revenge from Mars and Star Wars Episode One, the two Pin 2K games, which is your favorite?
I'm just going to say that this one, because anything with Jar Jar Binks is just eternally just bad.
So,
I prefer this one much better.
I prefer syrup.
I mean, just because a movie is bad doesn't necessarily mean the pinball
no,
has
the
pin, to be
the
bad.
Pinball, the pinball, I mean, this one actually is better. It's more fun to shoot this table than the Star Wars table. It's pretty limited on what you play in the Star Wars one.
It's funnier.
I love Congo, the pinball machine. Have you ever watched the movie?
Yeah, the super laser at the end just kills everything. That's great.
It's a great movie. Yeah. And there's a monkey running around or an ape or something. It's great.
Apparently, I have no idea what makes you guys tick.
It's Amy.
Well, Amy was a good gorilla.
She was a good gorilla. Okay, so if Greg gets one more here, he just completed the second one. He's going to start his third. If he completes this mode, then he'll start his multi-ball mode.
So I should say that I'm shooting ramps and targets and whatever. I could just shoot the center and complete all these modes, but I wouldn't be advancing towards...
That's correct.
You wouldn't be getting your flawless.
You'd be just getting regular. You'd just be getting the ship multi-balls, what you'd be getting.
I think it's an important design element that they allow you to finish modes just by shooting the center, because, you know, with the majority of novice players not being able to aim their shots or totally ignoring the outside elements of the game, just pounding it up the center still allows them to progress.
There we go. Look at that. And he got an extra ball, which won't happen. Or maybe it will.
No, it did. We turned them on.
Oh, you turned them on?
Yeah,
okay,
we,
cool.
We took it back off of tournament settings just to get a look at some of the different things the game has to offer.
We actually want to see Greg play the game as opposed to see the game play Greg.
Backhand that ramp, Greg. Come on. You can do it. Backhand that ramp.
This ramp?
Yep, that ramp. You can do it. Oh, not that ramp.
Oh,
I'm at
the left ramp.
I'm at the interior ramp, yes.
Oh, but I already...
That's okay. You're good.
I'm a flawless individual.
We see this. That's three times over you were flawless. That was very impressive.
You're a dapper individual.
So, bonus wave multi-ball. Okay, so here he has to collect weapons.
All right, so there's going to be a strafing 2X that I can take across the playfield as well.
And how do you do that, Greg?
There's actually two flipper buttons on each side. You can't see one of them.
So those are those little half flipper buttons that are attached to the main buttons on the pin 2Ks.
That is correct. And you can alternate through and select which one you want as you make them each time.
But I have pretty big hands, and I hit them often by accident.
Yeah, I agree. These are not the most ergonomical designed things on a pinball machine.
Ah, that was terrible.
Yeah, it was.
Not the best.
No, if you would have got 40, you would have completed the mode, but you were way off of 40.
What?
It would have been an extra ball.
Yeah.
Well, you know, he can still go back through.
Exactly.
It doesn't really matter when you do it. You just have to make sure you get to 40.
All right, here I want to knock out these four Martians. One.
Love the way they integrated the
ramp,
graphics.
Ramp, middle guy. Oh, well. Middle guy.
There he goes. Yeah, it's pretty amazing if you look at this, just the graphics. A lot of people don't particularly care for the style of the game, but... graphically, the game is amazing.
Yeah, this game was, 14 years ago, and I would say the closest approximation of integrating graphics like that would be the P3 people right now.
Yeah. Yeah,
this is very different. It was one of the things that made it tough to play, I would say. I can't see the back of the ramps. What I see is a screen.
Does that bother you as a player? I mean, do you...
It does.
Does it make it more difficult to aim your shots?
It makes it more difficult to time them.
Oh, okay.
Because I can't see the ball the whole time.
Do you think that you're affected by playing underneath a canopy with cameras all around you?
No, I think that's actually helping me.
He's blocked off from anybody seeing his play except for everybody on the internet.
Well, I mean, this is the only way we can give him treatment for the Black Plague as well as watch him play pinball at the same time, so...
We're actually not broadcasting, Greg. We're just trying to torture you.
I want to get the one I got. Aerobics.
Bowling. Martian bowling.
Aerobics.
Martian bowling is fun.
To answer the question on Twitch, sitting next to me, Nicole, is Fred Cochran. And he's with me. I'm John Replogle, and Mark Steinman is on the controls tonight.
Nice shout out to Space Invaders.
Give me something good to eat. That's not as good as I wanted.
A Martian bomb.
But I'll take it.
Actually, this
is... So this plays a little different from Attack's Martian Attack. There's only two.
Nice save, Greg.
Two Martians to hit, and then the ramp will come up.
And you get to the monster Martian.
And I start the money bomb.
Man, you made his head explode. Exploded it.
Very graphic. Splatted it. So now we got the baby Martians out now.
Yes, and if I destroy all the Martians and the one that comes up afterwards, I actually get another saucer light.
So are you trying to do it in a particular order? Or you just have to kill all the Martians until they stop coming up?
No, I didn't.
If you would have.
If I would have, I'd have been a winner.
Mothership multi-ball.
Okay, so this is the regular multi-ball, comparable to the Attack from Mars regular multi-ball.
Yes.
Is there anything else you can progress on while you're doing this? I don't think so, right?
I think it's just multi-ball.
Well, you want to destroy these saucers, right. 10 of them, I think, and then I will light a super jackpot that strafes along the bottom.
Does the Super Jackpot give you a saucer?
I think so.
Okay.
It might not.
Yeah,
I'm really struggling with multi-balls right now.
Well, don't worry about us. We're just sitting here watching you. You know, all thousands of people watching you.
We're talking about you too, Greg.
Are you saying good things or bad things?
I don't know. You have headphones on. You have to disseminate it yourself.
It's a mixed bag, Greg.
And Hey Rocker says, is this a good game for tournament play? Why or why not?
It can and it can't be. I mean, that's such a loaded question because games that are awful tournament games in certain formats can be excellent tournament games in other formats. I mean, if you're playing pin golf, you can use virtually anything because you don't have to worry about, you know, lengthy game times or anything like that because you're the person who sets the target scores. But if you're putting this into, you know, a repeated qualifying attempt type tournament where players get to play it, you know, 20, 25 times, it can get lengthy. It can get boring. And personally, I would say overall, yeah, it's fine. Well, you don't see it a whole lot because it's nearly impossible to set the cameras up to watch it.
Did I actually miss him? I felt like I hit him.
Well, he felt like you hit him too.
Wolf and Oz had a question in regards to the system that this game is running off of, the new core system, which was basically the linked internet system, so you could have online tournaments with this game with the software in it. It is not.
I don't think. Yeah, I mean, no. I don't think we have any reason to have that installed. But also, wasn't the new core flat screen monitor set up too, or is that something else I'm thinking?
I think it might be because Al has the Revenge with the new core, and then it has the traditional setup.
Yeah. I really want to hit him.
And that was the new core for sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, yeah.
I thought the new core was the new processor unit, which converted it to an LCD.
Yeah, we'll see if we can find that out.
Maybe our audience can help us with that question.
I actually just gave up on trying to hit him.
Oh, you got flawless, though, so you must have gave up at the right time.
Okay, so now he has 17 to start. He still has to get to 40, so we need him to do a little more.
A little more work?
You need to do better.
More work.
You need to do better.
I need to have a multi-ball that lasts.
Don't we all?
Greg, this is the longest I've seen you play pinball and not shout or scream or dance.
I'm trying to hold back.
We don't want you to do that. We want you to be yourself, Greg. When you want to bust a move, man.
To be honest, afraid that I would just start swearing randomly.
That's okay. This is the internet. Swearing is allowed.
Now, you know, we
are trying to get
within reason.
There we go.
Aww.
I'm doing stuff.
Making shots.
Just don't karate kick the camera pole beside you.
I still failed, so we're going to have to do it on the last one, I think.
Well,
you only need 7 more, so you're not that far away.
No.
I love weapons.
Yes.
This one I actually find to be quite difficult. Alien abduction. They just start taking stuff.
Yeah, but then you get more points whenever you get it early, though. Every time you finish one, the point value goes up.
I mean, why are the Martians taking stuff? You know, like, they take
from
our
Bill
women.
Clinton.
Well, you know, the technology at the time allowed them to.
I think they're actually taking things back.
You think it's theirs?
So Bill Clinton actually stole women from the Martians?
Oh, well,
imagine that. That makes perfect sense.
Boy, no, you're back on the women thing. I mean, everyone knows the answer to that, John.
Actually, it just got a whole lot foggier, didn't it?
No, I was thinking about the, you know, like the Area 51 technology.
I thought you were talking about, like, you know, you remember Bill Clinton.
What is that like... what's his name? The guy Clinton, the Funkadelic.
Here we go. Here we go. I destroyed some ships.
Now it's going to scroll across the screen. You got to hit it in the middle where the red light is, or in where the orbit shots are. And there goes one. Now he's got it. Super jackpot, and he got a saucer light for that. So that is
baby.
True, Greg. You did get a saucer light for
indeed.
That, Greg.
Indeed. Oh.
Unfortunate.
Gross.
Shoot again.
I'm going to shoot again if that's all right with you guys.
Yeah, shoot all over the place.
So now look at your shots now, Greg. You were talking about how it gets they keep taking stuff, but look at your point values.
Oh, they're good?
Oh, look at that. It started counting down from 3 million.
You can read that? I can't even barely see that.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
It's okay, John. I'm older than you, and I don't even have my glasses on.
I think I'm two shots away from the missile extra ball.
How many shots is it? 15?
It's 20. I have 18.
Okay.
I think I saw that. Maybe someone can confirm. It's so quiet.
The tension is just unbearable.
I can bear it.
You blew up the saucer. You saved the White House. Way to go. Bill Clinton lives.
Bill Clinton has survived. Thank you.
They didn't have to take him down to the bunker.
I actually saw a great Bill Clinton reference.
So I
got to
knock these five guys off the stools.
I saw a great Bill Clinton reference the other day. I was watching old cartoon intros just because that's what you do. And he was in the beginning of the Animaniacs.
Really?
Yeah.
What was he doing?
He was just playing a saxophone. It made me laugh.
Oh, yeah. He did used to play the saxophone. Well, he probably still does play the saxophone, but I knew that. But I also used to love the Animaniacs, so that's a good reference.
You know, why was there never an Animaniacs pinball machine?
Hint, hint.
Didn't Steven Spielberg do the Animaniacs?
I really don't know.
For some reason, I think he did. Chat room, find out.
One more shot, Greg. Get that left orbit to get that missile. Get that missile.
The missile. Yeah, we'll get that.
There
missile.
It is. There goes your extra ball, sir. We're here to help you, Greg.
Thank you.
You got it.
To answer your question, Evan.
Oh, that was risky.
I am definitely going to play in that side tournament that is being put on, and I have not yet decided if I'm going to submit a video. I mean, exactly what would I put in a video?
That's not already on.
Gentleman John talking about pinball.
Just to explain what Evan's talking about, there at the Pinball Expo this year, there is going to be a side tournament. If you are ranked in the top 250 players in the world, you can email Mr. Josh Sharp, the president of the IFPA, and he will give you one entry to the tournament. If you submit some sort of video to Mr. Josh Sharp, you know, maybe it's a video of, well, let's just leave it right there.
Yeah, here's a multi ball that you don't always get. Here's an opportunity.
Martian Hypnobeam.
This is like stroke of luck.
John, I think you and I should do a video.
So every one of these little spirals that I hit will add another ball. We might as well just add some balls because I like doing that.
You know what? We should do a video, Fred.
Their balls aren't firing, though.
We'll come up with something. I think we should do a wrestling video. You can bring back your wrestling persona.
So this is the equivalent of the strobe multi-ball from the original Attack from Mars. I like that they made a point of referencing other games.
It's a lot more disorienting, too, if you look at that thing. My God, it's like high anxiety.
The interesting thing about this is whenever you add the ball, you get that many balls in play. Let me explain that a little better.
So it's not,
you get them all.
So it's not a traditional add a ball. It resets your progress and gives you. So if you're up to, if you hit your third spiral, then it'll give you all of your balls back up to that point.
Exactly. So
it's far more lucrative than just
right,
a traditional add a ball.
So there's my completion. I better get it.
Bam. Right on cue, GM.
Wow, there's a lot of extra balls in this game.
Well, yeah. I think this is set for. I think. Well, maybe not.
I think they thought I was going to play it, so they put it on extra easy level, and then you just took over, and you're playing it.
Actually, you know what? This is a good point. Nicole just said, do a video now. So, actually, I'd like to take this next 5 seconds to say, this is John Replogle, and this is my video. I love playing pinball. Thank you very much.
I will chime in and second what John says. I love pinball, and I love broadcasting GMG. Blowing up revenge from Mars. That is my video, Mr. Sharp, so I want my entry.
What's your strategy from this point on, Greg?
I want to complete as many of these modes as I can and get as many saucer lights as I can. So I know I have another saucer light in bonus wave multi-ball. And I have the saucer light I just got here.
Greg, why don't you give a brief explanation of the lights across the play field and tell us what each one represents, because some new players to the game may not know.
These green, yellow, orange, red, those are the modes that I'm doing. I think one might be out. The lights on this across the play field here are the saucer lights that I'm collecting. This one is an automatic flawless. All you got to do is beat them. So
what's the quickest way to do that?
Hit the center, I suppose, but that's also the most dangerous.
Yeah, if you miss.
But
at the
I'm
end,
I'm gonna go ahead and do this one again.
At the end, if you do the flawless victory, it actually takes a nod to Mortal Kombat and says flawless victory.
Well, I think it's always a flawless victory.
There's a lot of games.
He goes away.
It just kind of does the voice a little bit, is what it, I guess what I was saying.
I mean, there was lots of games that had Mortal Kombat hints in them, too. I mean, there's lots of games.
No fear.
Well, the game was, I mean, the game has a, the designers of the game have a history in pinball. It was the Boon Brothers, wasn't it? And they worked for Midway at the time?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, that's an interesting trivia question somebody could answer, is like, how many actual games had Mortal Kombat 3 references to in them?
Wasn't Ed Boon the voice of Rudy in Funhouse?
I did not know that.
I'm pretty sure. I think it was one of the Boons.
I can't answer that.
I can say that Ed Boon might be a totally nice guy, but I don't know if I'd want him hanging around in my house then. You know, just
cause you think he's not your friend?
Hey, Biff.
I was going to say, hey, Biff, it's time to wake up.
I actually don't want to do this, but...
Pinball Wiz says this definitely needs to be in pro pinball, and how would you actually do something like that?
I don't know. Like, the integration of the hologram across the...
Do you guys know if I'm forced to do this or if this will time out?
I don't know.
We say hit it. We're always in favor of shooting dangerous things.
Well, we don't believe in timing things out.
I think that's the safest way to do it anyways.
Yes, up the middle with the lock shot is the safest way, yes. Provided you hit it, of course.
Don't you have, like, 19 extra balls at this point, too?
I have one, and I'd really like to finish all the modes.
Play with no fear, Greg.
I'm down by a billion.
That's right. Ed Boon was the voice of Rudy, just so that's official.
All right.
Thank you, chat room.
Yes, thank you.
Does the chat room answer any questions that we ask? Can I, like, you know, can someone out there do my taxes or?
Steve Ritchie actually was the fatality.
That was worth it, Greg. That was $16.5 million.
Wait, did I just hear that correctly? Steve Ritchie did in the actual Mortal Kombat.
That's
his voice.
Yeah, that's what I'm being told in the chat room.
That's another great trivia question.
That's very cool. Thank you very much.
It's trivia night on PAPAtv.
You ask us trivia, we won't know it, but we'll ask other people.
and we'll take absolute credit for it, of course.
I just, you know, just so you know, I knew that Steve Ritchie was, I came up with that and I fed it in there, right? Oh.
Epic fail.
Thankfully, you have the 12 extra
balls,
Greg.
This is my last extra ball.
All right, do the super skill shot then.
Nah.
No?
He was the voice of Shao Kahn.
It's too loose. It comes out too far on the
Yeah,
flipper.
It does. Bam. Uh-oh.
I kicked his butt.
Oh. I kicked your Martian butt to the moon.
That was a pretty good impression there for Christ.
Nah, my voice cracked, actually. It was terrible.
So that's... This is the final bonus wave multi-ball.
Seven shots, Greg. Seven shots.
Don't mess this up. You're on live TV. No, really, please don't.
Okay, 34. There it is.
Mothership.
Okay, so now this is the big one.
And then you just gotta hit that big spaceship in the middle. Kind of like Independence Day.
Do I see that NASA has retrofitted the Challenger in Columbia shuttles with laser beams?
What?
It's a freaking laser.
Or what would it be? The Atlantis? Or I can't remember which one it was back then.
I stink.
All that work for that.
That was pathetic.
There we go, Greg.
Oh, you blew it up. Sort of.
Yes, but I would have got this.
So now you're going to actually get the chance to go back through. This is actually a pretty good game of Revenge from Mars, just to...
So in the prequel to this game, in Attack from Mars, Mars is attacking Earth. And in this one, we get to fly... Oh, well, no, I guess what? To rule the universe, you attack Mars in the first one as well. So in that storyline, they're the same.
I think the Martians are being a little more subversive in this one.
I got to go get him. That's what I've been told.
Yeah, there he's flying out. There it is. And it is retrofitted, Mark. That is confirmed. Now
I got to shoot him with this, these little things.
So what Greg is talking about is there the target, if you see in the middle of the cursor, he can rotate the ships into the cursor with the action buttons by the flipper buttons.
Oh, wow.
To shoot them while he's playing pinball, which it makes it very challenging, actually.
Wolf and Nas, you really have all the facts, don't you? He says, Mark, this is a Boeing X-37.
Wow.
And this is the same guy who just gave us the answer on the Steve Ritchie.
Is that the Scramjet?
And Ed Boon.
And Ed Boon. No, Roy Wills was first with Ed Boon.
He's a wealth of knowledge this evening. It's great. Makes our job that much easier.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
I got rubbed.
You are making us look intelligent, which that's really hard to do.
Bowen chimes in, and that's some finally some red button action. And it's, like I said, it's very difficult to do this.
Did I get my Adderall?
Oh, you got that big green glob there.
I did get my Adderall.
And you got a ball save.
Which is good, because he doesn't have any balls.
I don't know what you're saying.
Why are you fighting the great and powerful
Why
Oz?
Are the balls not coming out?
It is. Don't, hey, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain under there. That is so literal now. It That's makes like, perfect sense.
I didn't know they put Metroid in a pinball machine.
Oh, it does look like it. Mother Brain.
Mother Brain.
Brought to you by the Replay Effects Festival. The Mother Brain.
The Mother Brain reference.
Or the Metroid.
I really want to play Mr. D's Wild Ride on camera now.
Oh, we had some brutal matches on that a little bit ago. We'll break it out at some point. Not tonight, though.
No, not tonight, but some point in the future.
I could have done more, but you get the idea.
You've been down on yourself the entire game, and you're the entire way to the...
You got to check that left flipper. Where's Doug Polka to come fix a flipper when you need it? Look at that. Oh, my God.
Oh, what a slap save. That was brutal.
Jeez Louise, it's not registering. There you go. The tension in the room is just unbearable. Can he make it? This is, let's go, that's 15.
Mother Brain's going to win again.
And that Mother Brain is rough. 80 million stage 3 bonus.
I'm trying to get it, but it's counting down on me.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, boy.
Bye-bye.
And that, folks, is how that goes.
And he is
Greg,
now
that was a great game.
The Thank grand you. Champion.
Nice game, Greg.
GM Money.
GM well, GM. That actually about takes all of our time on on Revenge from Mars. Believe it or not, Greg, you nailed that on take one, so good job, man.
Thank you.
Well, take this. Could have done off. A little bit better with the Martian, but you did a pretty nice job.
Actually, somebody tried to type in a little reference from a certain Arnold Schwarzenegger movie about Mars, but they didn't let him type it because you can't get your beep to Mars.
Yeah, so anyone out there wanted to see how we had the camera set up, this will give you a decent idea. You can see it's a little bit of a mess.
Greg, go over there and show them where the camera is above the game. It's kind of hard. It blends in. So that's where the camera that Greg was standing right underneath with his head.
Greg had a very narrow window to work.
And again, if you see right now, he's looking very dapper. He's sweating, but he's looking great. Nice job, Greg.
All right, so I think we're moving over to Derby Day.
Oh, dear. Aren't we having a grudge match on Derby Day?
Yeah, I believe so. Who's involved in that?
Dacey Diesel and Chris Stevens are going to play a grudge match of Derby Day. I don't know. You guys announced it as a grudge match. The aforementioned grudge match. What's that? Well, it started whenever I beat you on Freedom, when I rolled it on you, and then you just taken it out on Chris. I think there should be a game
next. So we're about to jump into Derby Day here, which is an electromechanical game from 1967 by Williams, based on horse racing. And I'm assuming this game has rules, but I don't think they matter.
Is there gambling, or is there like the Triple Crown or anything like this?
No
Triple Crown?
This is one of those games where the outlanes are really wide. It's very difficult to keep the ball in play for any length of time. There actually are rules, and we're going to jump into them here in a little bit. The basic premise of the game is that you're hitting horses. There's a row of targets at the top of the play field, and each one of those represents a horse, and the horse will progress down the track. Lit horses, I believe, move farther and are worth more points. And then the ball plunges out from between the flippers, which is unusual for modern pinball machines, at least.
It has a little target thing, too, that you can aim your shot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll get to see a little bit of that. And the skill shot is just dead center, straight up the middle, right? Is worth 300 points?
Yeah, I believe
yes.
so, yeah.
300 points.
Yeah.
Brian Dye probably hit it a few times.
Hey. I did. I hit it once. In all of Classics, I hit it once.
Yeah, this game was what just used in Classics 1 at Papa 17?
Yeah, Papa 17.
Big hit, a smash hit of the weekend.
Go Future Glue, Papa Doug says. I like that.
Future Glue was a big favorite during the Papa weekend. I think we discussed this a little bit during the last broadcast. People were naming the horses, and one of the favorites was Future Glue.
I like that. If you're looking up on the monitor there, I don't know if you see it or not, but the Replay FX Arcade and Gaming Festival, July 30th to August 2nd. Biggest arcade in history.
It's going to be a great time. It's going to be awesome. You'll have a chance to play Mr. G's Wild Ride.
It's going to be incredible. Pinball Expo.
I want to encourage everyone to come out here. This is the granddaddy of all pinball expos. Always a good time.
Papa will be in the house.
Next circuit event coming up, Fraser Valley Flipout. Make sure you check this out, and if you're in the area or not in the area, come on up. I believe John is moving, setting up a microphone for Derby Day so that we can have all the awesome sound effects that this game has to offer.
You can hear the soundtrack.
Yeah.
You know what? Actually, I think about this going back a couple weeks when we were playing Coney Island. When you hit the spinner, it sounds like horses galloping. We need to superimpose that sound on this game so we can
just
hear
a
the
loop. Yeah, just a solid loop.
Just a solid loop
game.
So this game is galloping and EM sounds. That'd be terrific.
All right. Can we let them know whenever? Go ahead and fire it up, Chris.
It's a pretty in-depth strategy. I'm sure Chris uses a number of different strategies when he plays this game. It's so deep.
So as you can see there, the bright light there in the middle is worth 300 points, and the skill shot per se is aiming that little moving red target at the bottom near the drain. Well, in the drain.
Oh, perfect.
You hit it right off the bat.
It's one of the few times where you actually do head for the light.
And you can see the horses moving across the little display there, right below the scores. This game actually is a lot of fun. We played a game called Zodiac up at the Michigan Pinball Expo not too long ago that was a similar type of game, and I walked into the tournament and I was, you know, kind of looking at it and just like a little
that was nasty
looking at it, and was a little frustrated because I didn't fully understand it, and by the end of the weekend I was still frustrated and didn't really understand it, but it was a good sign.
You referred to it as some kind of box,
a luck box.
That's right, a luck box.
No,
it's the greatest thing ever.
You do get an opportunity to aim sometimes, but there's definitely some games whenever you walk up to these and they just don't treat you well.
So Chris got, what's ball one? He's got 1,300, and that's about pretty much every game I've played so far on one ball.
Yeah, I think he just beat my high score on Derby Day.
Yeah.
That's a good ball one, I guess. He can do better.
Daisy Diesel's stepping up to the machine here. She's got the headphones on now. She has to listen to us ramble on here about...
Now that I have a mic, what was this stuff about freedom?
Oh, you don't want to talk about freedom. Don't talk about freedom. That's a bad part of your life right there that you don't want to relive.
There's a question in the chat. Does Papa have Little Joe? That's a super funny M, says Hey Rocker. We do not have a Little Joe.
We have Little Chief. Is that related to Little Joe?
Little Chef, we like to call it here.
I don't think so. I'm not sure.
We have Big Indian. We have Big Game. We have a lot of little and big stuff.
Big Guns?
Big Guns. I don't think we have Little Joe, though.
No Little Joe.
Sorry. Or how about like Al Bundy when he said Biggins? Do we have that?
Biggins.
Yeah.
Focus, Fred.
So I'm just trying to get the Daisy Diesel distracted here. I think it's kind of working because she is giggling.
Yeah. That's today. You know what? I need to practice with distractions, so please... Trash talk all you want.
Okay.
Daisy, I think you were telling me not too long ago about some pinball costumes, some contests, or you had a word for it.
Yeah. So it's actually a thing. The Northern Lights tournament that's coming up in Manchester. They're already doing this. They're doing a pinball cosplay. I thought I was being original by dressing up as Daisy Diesel, but they already do a contest for it with prizes. And there's pictures on their site, people dressing up like the aliens. Someone doing the,
just
Mars Trek chick would be kind of cool, too.
See, if I was going to tell you to kick Chris's kneecaps for that outline save.
Yeah, that was totally ridiculous. Yeah, okay, anyways.
So you do have, Daisy, you do have one up on the other pin costume people in that you were the voice of Daisy Diesel and Mustang. So, you know, that is one in your corner in originality. I don't think there's too many people out there who can lay claim to that.
No. And that was fun dressing up like that character. So hopefully if I get more Stern work, you'll be seeing more costumes. I think it'd be fun. I think it'd be another way to get more people in.
So, I mean, would you actually dress up, you know, as whatever the character is? Like, if they redid Algar, are you just, you know, going down that road with, you know, the giant beast suit, or does it?
I am.
Is it,
okay. I'm going to do Gorgar, then Algar, and then El Tomka.
All right, we have it live. You've committed to this.
So you'll see there next to the 300-point light that he's lit another target at the top. And
Not this time, Chris.
Sorry, Chris.
You can't get a Lazarus every time you play.
All right, so...
So I got some work to do here.
Someone has to explain the your horses rule in this game to me. There's a way to claim horses and use them to your favor. Can someone shed any light on this? No one can shed any light on
this. No, not me. I've played this game like once. Yeah, I've played this game one time ever.
Okay. Well, someone in the chat room needs to fire off with this because...
I know Todd Seaver's in here. I know Todd knows the old games well. So, Todd, help us out here.
Yeah. There are some instances where we act like we don't know the rules and really do, but in this case, we genuinely don't know the rules.
I think Elizabeth would know, too, because she loves this game. When she heard the Derby Day was in, she was screaming it from the rooftops from day one.
Oh, she gets one.
And it Lazarus into a big shot there. Look at that.
Uh-oh. Bye-bye. Derby
game
Day.
Over.
All right. Are we actually going to suffer through another game of this, or are we moving over to Space Station?
This is for documentation.
Oh, documentation. All right, one more game of Derby Day, and then we're going to head over to Space Station. And in case anyone out there doesn't know, the FSPA, the Free State Pinball Association, is going to be doing a live broadcast today. That's one of the reasons we cut out a little bit early. We're going to give you more information about that before we sign off, but we encourage you to check in on their broadcast as soon as we sign off here today.
Yeah, props to those guys. They've done a really, really good job putting together their broadcasts. I've tuned in as much as possible, saw some gameplay on Airborne. That was the most recent one I caught up on. I think it was for their finals. They're doing a really good job down there, so good job, guys. Keep up the
Yeah, good people
down
there.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Very nice people.
Oh, that was a public service announcement to Roy Wills. I caught it at the last second. Let's see if Roy responds. Ugh.
Fred, you're a classics guy. What do you do if you walk up to this in a tournament and you don't know what you're doing?
I actually call Todd Seaver, who says that two-player games, each player has three horses. When a horse is collected eight times, that horse wins.
Six
and is claimed. Six horses. Sorry, my eyes.
So my question is how to claim a horse. That's what I'm mostly wondering.
Are they chosen for you? I think they're chosen for you.
We're going to find out from Todd here in a second because he'll answer the question, I'm sure. No, when I walk up to one of the old games, it really you analyze the play field and see what lights what if you can, if off the scorecard or off the play field. Fred is blind, Doug says. Thank you, Doug. And just shoot for the lit shots. It sounds simple, but that's kind of what you do with some of these old games. You hit the lights, and it pays off. Hopefully that helped. Doug says you claim the horses by branding it with a hot iron. So that narrows it down very, very nicely. Thank you, Doug, for the chiming in. Bowen with a more reasonable answer.
Player one gets horses 1, 3, and 5. Player two gets 2, 4, and 6.
No, but for some reason I thought it was possible to claim more than just that. Is it really just that simple? You're saddled with 1, 3, 5, and then it switches to 2, 4, 6. Because for some reason I feel like I've seen both lit at different times.
Well, he says Todd says here, each time you hit a target up at the top, each target is a different horse. Still doesn't clarify anything for me.
that doesn't tell us how horses are.
Todd, I know you're trying to help. I'm just stupid, so you know, just I'm just going with that as my answer. And as we're sitting here trying to find out answers, I'm watching House Ball Galore over here on my left.
Yeah, I mean, well, one thing, I guess the reason that I've never really paid attention to the rules in this game is that any time I play it, I don't think it changes what I do. You just shoot for the lit shots and try and keep the ball up to the top of the play field as much as possible. I mean, it's you occasionally get a ball cradled or get to aim at something, but it's really not that often.
Right.
Hey, we have a special request in the chat room, Mark, and you may want to do this one. Bowen says his son wants to hear somebody say bow.
All right, Aaron. This one's for you. You want to go all three at once, guys?
Yep.
Sure. All right, 1, 2, 3.
Bow. That was pretty bad. A barbershop quartet we are not.
Aaron is Bowen's young one and is the reason Bowen enters the initials AJK after he gets onto the high scoreboards.
We all just said bow, Bowen. And I just said it again.
And Debris.
And Debris, yes. The Debris. Avoid the Debris. I guess Debris in this game would be horse manure.
Yeah,
maybe.
Valid point.
Okay.
Taken.
That would be the Debris.
This is what happens whenever you make people talk about two straight two-player games of Derby Day.
We are.
This is
this
called,
horse has gone off the track.
Yeah, this is called filler.
Horse has gone wild.
Yeah, this is horse has gone wild.
We gotta put this horse down.
Horse has a broken leg. It's time to go.
AJK. We can name the
really?
Horse AJK.
I mean,
did you just
did
tell?
That just happen? What was that?
Was that just a he didn't hit a switch. Oh jeez.
You're actually gonna three switch rule Derby Day?
I can't
get him off of there.
All right, guys,
that's ridiculous.
It's time to turn the power off on Derby Day.
Get that stick that Mark turns the power off and just club him in the back of the knee like with a kendo stick.
No. The Louisville Arcadexo guys gave us a Louisville Slugger one year with Pop on the back, so we could brand Chris if we hit him with a hard knock.
Oh, my goodness.
Hey, Chris, why don't you try to alley pass for us here?
Yeah, what? Shats the outlane, Chris.
That worked last week on demo, man.
Chris is going to shats the outlanes here.
How many balls are left?
He has his kickback lit.
I think the last time I ever heard anything was All the Humanity when the Hindenburg blew up.
So to go back a little bit before
there,
she drained
the outlanes for you.
She had a couple lights lit up top, and you light those. Instead of the targets being worth, like, -2 points or whatever they're worth on this game, they actually become worth 100 points after that horse has finished and gone to the end of the, race.
Brian, start over completely.
Sure. So you see how there's one light lit at the top
right
now. That's the 300-point shot that is always lit. And there are other lights next to it. You see how those two just lit up there?
Right.
Those all correspond to a horse up top. Whenever a horse gets to the end of the finish line, that horse's number will light for 100 points each time you hit the target,
awesome.
Compared to whenever it's just, it's worth like 1 point whenever it's not lit.
Mm-hmm. Point by point.
I think the flippers above the outlane inspired the design on Star Trek for the away team. It's perfect. Look at it. It's perfect. You can. It's absolutely perfect.
This game needs to be over.
No way, man. I could do this all day long, folks.
We're going to have a Derby Day special in a few weeks, so we just play this for hours.
I thought you were going to say it was like the old Chicago special where we set it on fire.
No, all things considered, this is a fun game. It's a really good game.
I disagree.
I enjoy it. I do.
Some people, well, anyways, I'm not going to go there.
All right, is this the
last ball?
Last
right,
ball.
So maybe Mark, if you can answer this question, Mark, are we planning on getting the America's Most Haunted here for the lineup for Papa?
Oh, no, there's one more. That wasn't the last ball. This is the ball. I'm not sure. We're kind of taking a wait-and-see approach with a lot of those things. You know, there's a lot of new games coming out from the smaller manufacturers, and it's a lot of money to sink into a bunch of different companies. So, you know, if people start putting out a good product, then we're going to be interested in it and trying to find a way to accumulate those games. But, you know, like I said, we're in a holding pattern at this point.
Okay, very good.
Is this a 10-ball game?
Well, yeah.
When you have two players in a 5-ball game, yes, it is a 10-ball game.
That's actually very true. Doug's trying to be smart. We're smarter. Well, at least Brian Dye is anyway. He's a doctor, so. No, somebody just pressed the start button again. No, somebody didn't press the start button, did they?
No. Are we done?
Yes, we are definitely done with Derby Day. We're going to Space Station next.
Derby Day!
We're going to move over some microphones and then move on to game number 3-4 of the night. You can see some of us see Brian Dye shuffling out of the booth.
I think I'm actually going to get down and play this against Brian.
You're going to play Space Station?
Greg, you want to come up here? Greg's going to come up. CDs, you want to come up?
Yeah.
Come on, you guys can take over.
Brian, we're going to sit John in one of these seats.
Oh, okay. Then I'll let you decide that. I'll wait till he gets the microphone and everything ready. I like playing badly on camera, Mark, as a evidence a couple weeks ago, where you and I couldn't hit anything on Centaur.
Wolf. Fred, what do you know about Space Station?
Williams. It's a Williams game. What is it? Mid 80s?
87.
Multi-ball game. It's all outlanes on the sides there. But it's a fun game. It's a shooter's game. There's a few shots that are tough to make. The lock shot's difficult, but once you get dialed in, it's pretty easy. It's interesting setup with the spaceship up there. When you hit the target down, to shoot it up on the spaceship to get the hurry up. It's a fun game. I enjoy it.
A little bit of a unique lower play field we're going to see in a second here. No, it doesn't have the traditional slingshots with the inlanes like most games.
All right. Space Station. And so, Brian, is this your first time... giving us a shot playing the game?
Oh, no. During PAPA 17, I had a shot there at the end of qualifying.
Right.
And yeah, it was a glorious time choking on live TV.
There's nothing better than choking on live TV.
It was awesome.
We'd like to see you do it again.
It was a good time. Sure.
Without the choke.
I would be more than happy to.
I think you guys should wager something on this game.
What,
yeah, put something on the line.
I mean, they can't wager real money. How about like Monopoly money or something like that?
I think we need to do something like that. We need to start a series here. How much money do you get whenever you start Monopoly?
$1,500.
$1,500. All right. So this is what we're going to do. Each one of us is going to take $1,500, and it's going to last, say, I don't know, John, how long? Until we have one winner.
Why don't we say that everybody that's here is starting with 1,500 virtual Monopoly dollars.
We're gonna have to actually bring out real Monopoly
this
money.
This is a thing right now. This is happening.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. You guys each have 1,500. Decide what you're going to put on the line.
I'm going all in. I'm pushing 1,500. Nothing to lose.
Well, there's nothing like that guy who walks up to the table and is just like, well, I'm going to let it ride.
All right. Well, one of you is going to have no money after one game.
Okay.
So. And that's true. You do. That is Monopoly Pinball the only game where you would get actual points when you start the game? I mean, like Monopoly Pinball, you start with 1,500 points, you know, to signify the $1,500.
I guess Fred needs to either accept or decline.
Fred, he's saying he wants to go all in against you.
All right, here it is.
Fred is accepting. So all right. For all their Monopoly dollars, Brian Dye
is
all in. Fred Cochran needs to win this because he's going to need a lead to play against anybody else in the world.
We're going to have to start coming up with like graphics and whatnot if we're going to do this weekly so that we can keep people updated on the score sheet.
I think we need to get a telestrator.
You know what? We should make I have a better idea. Whoever loses
You can buy back in through various feats of strength that you have to perform live on Papa TV.
Oh, my goodness. This could only go wrong. Mark, where do you come up with this stuff? Do you just sit around at home thinking stuff up?
No, actually, believe it or not, the feats of strength came from my brother's wedding. I have two brothers, and in order to determine the best man, he made us perform several different feats of strength, and whoever won became his best man.
Okay. Also, I'd like to welcome to the microphone Greg Delanner. Greg, welcome to Papa TV Live.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Cool, man. Did you feel like you had a good game on Revenge?
Say yes. Say yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
I feel like I should have said boom when I walked off, but I forgot.
Now's your chance.
Boom.
Boom.
Nice.
Well, I believe your initials were announced as GM Money, so that's almost as good.
Papa Doug. Thank you, Doug. My money is on John, says Doug. I like that.
All right, so for $1,500 Monopoly dollars, what is the strategy on this game?
Whenever you start your game, your locks are automatically lit through the left orbit. You can see the flashing green light on the left right there. As of right now, that's where he wants to go to. That's the first shot in the multi-ball to light your jackpot. And you will shoot that a second time to collect the rescue jackpot, which starts out at, I believe, 200,000 points. But when you're starting, like I said, your locks are already lit.
And is that rescue jackpot multiplied by the ABC rollovers, or is it multiplied by something else?
I think that's multiplied by something else. Okay. So right there, he scored about 230,000.
Oh, that's right. The ABC multiplies
the stop and score.
The stop and score. Okay.
So you want to go for multi-ball.
Farsight Studios asked if we are going to be on long enough for us to send our fans here. Actually, sorry, Farsight, we're going to be offline by 8:30 at the very latest tonight.
You're more than welcome to check back in next Wednesday, I believe, John. Is that the next time we're going to be jumping on?
Yeah, we should be next Wednesday, probably around 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And but we thank you for the offer. We appreciate that. I mean, you guys are welcome to come over and check out another half hour of pinball, which is probably about what we have left.
So he scores his second jackpot of the multi-ball, and looks like I'm losing $1,500 Monopoly dollars.
What is your feat of strength going to be? I guess we'll have to ask the chat room. They can determine what it is.
That's a great idea. That's a really good idea.
So, chat room, your mission is to determine what feat of strength Brian Dye needs to do. And keep in mind, none of those feats of strength can involve beating up John or anything like that.
So I have a question about this game.
Go ahead, Greg.
So I see there's shuttle.
Yep.
Up the left side. What happens if you spell shuttle?
Okay, so what happens if you spell shuttle? In the middle of the play field, there's a rectangle that has two little triangles. Nice job, Fred. So this row of lights right here corresponds to shuttle, and this row of lights here on the right side corresponds to station. Whenever you complete the shuttle lights, you score whatever is lit here. So in this example, if I were to complete shuttle right now, I would score 50,000 points, plus it lights your bonus ball at the end of the game. If I were to finish station, which here is STA and the rest of TION for station, you'd score whatever is lit over here on the station side. So in that case, it would be 50,000 plus lights out lanes.
So are you actually actively shooting at those? I thought there were more things you avoided.
Usually not. Those come pretty much incidental to your multi-ball.
I think if you're playing in a bar or just like on location or something, an extra ball is one of the awards. I think it's a second from the top. Maybe take a few pot shots at it, but otherwise in tournament play, they happen.
Just ignore it, right. That's sort of how I felt about basically spelling shuttle in the original Space Shuttle as well. You know, most of the time you would ignore it, although I think it was actually a little more useful in shuttle because you would be actively going for the extra balls.
Brian, how are you feeling about your chances right now?
I'm feeling really great right now. I'm a ball three kind of guy.
Okay, all right. I like the confidence.
Wow, we have lots of good feet of strength ideas here.
Well, we'll have to wait and see who wins, and then we'll jump into that.
Please tell me one of them is me pile driving him through the game. a big old power bomb. That would be all right. So yeah, going back to the strategy, so you'll notice that he doesn't have his locks lit. And what relights his locks is the shot that he just shot. and completing the 1-2-3 1-2-3 rollovers up top, relight your locks. So what I'll typically do in a tournament setting is I'll light the first two, and then I'll, you know, purposely not get that third rollover. So that way when I come out of my multi-ball, the next time I'm in single ball play, I only have to make that shot once, because it's not a pleasant shot to make. There are two kind of big posts there that can send your ball out of control, and it's not really a safe shot. It's backhanded.
Brian, would you ever actively begin shooting the stop and score?
It depends. There is a way to multiply it, as you mentioned earlier, by spelling USA up top.
I guess
which are under the rollovers.
Before you jump into this, I guess for anyone who doesn't know, the stop and the score, is the right ramp, which is blocked by a drop target.
Right. So to activate the stop and score, you would shoot the drop target down the first time, which would open it up. You shoot the right ramp, which scores your stop and score. And a stop and score is a the value isn't necessarily random, but it cycles up from 25,000 up to 99,000 points. And wherever you know that score is, whenever the ball drops into the switch is what you score. So it gets kind of lucrative up towards, you know, three or four times multiplying whenever you'd be looking around 150,000 points or so, which is, you know, 3/4 of what your typical jackpot during multi-ball would be.
So right there, I noticed that you did not collect the 1-2-3. You intentionally moved it over.
Right, right. That's what I was talking about just a second ago. So the reason I do that is, so when I go back in a single ball play after my first multi ball is over, you know, given that I get to the first one, that to get back up to the top like I just did, so completing 1, 2, and 3 would relight my locks. So only having to make that shot once compared to three times is.
So it's a long play. You're setting yourself up for you know, for coming out of the multi-ball and having less shots to light the locks the second time through.
It's sort of like playing Creature from the Black Lagoon and only taking the two times a multiplier for your first super jackpot, because you're, the next multi-ball you get back to.
Actually, I think in Creature, probably the best analogy would be to leave one of the paid lanes.
Actually, that's a really good analogy there, Mark. Good idea.
So if he hits the L on shuttle, he'll get an extra ball?
Yes.
Yeah,
I don't think this is set up for extra balls, though. This is one of our tournament games, so he'll probably just get bubkiss.
I was actually trying to say something funny, and you brought it into actually a really valid point there, Mark. With
what, bubkiss?
No, actually, I was thinking with the paid lanes up top on Creature. So really, I mean, I guess Space Station, for all its beauty, you're really ignoring most of the playfield on this game. Doesn't that seem to be the case?
Yeah, like I said, a lot of the points from this come incidental to the multi-ball itself. And what you might have just noticed, I hit a bonus multiplier. There's a set of drop targets right here that are kind of hidden. You don't really notice them. But hitting, there are three drop targets right here, and hitting all three of those down actually advances your bonus multiplier.
That sort of seems like the side targets that would open the airlock on the original space shuttle. I wonder if anybody else thinks that's the same.
Oh.
Big old rejection.
Oh, nice shot. Those $1,500 $1,500 Monopoly dollars aren't gone yet.
Oh, nice little save in the middle. There goes one.
Really forced to play on the fly on this game a lot, not having the traditional lower play field. It's difficult to cradle.
Actually, and like, it's really nervous because it keeps telling you to do something, and you're like, I really want to please the computer that's telling me to do this.
You know, I've noticed that pinball machines do that a lot, it used to affect me when I was first learning how to play. You know, if there were countdowns or some kind of, like, time mode,
absolutely.
They try and rush you into things, and I noticed, you know, novice players hurrying up and rushing to it, and I used to do the same thing. And then after a while, all of a sudden, it just occurred to me, I'm not in a hurry. You know, I'm not going to put the ball out of risk or really try and do something crazy just to make sure that I get it in this last second for whatever the game is telling me to do or pressuring me into. You know, just take your time.
Well, actually, in this case, there really is no timer, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, the only thing, it's either you drain your ball or you make the shot eventually, right? So the only thing that's putting a fake timer on you is the thing that keeps saying, redock now.
Yeah, I think that game designers did that intentionally, trying to make players nervous, you know, either through sound effects or sound calls, just trying to make them speed up and put the ball out of play.
Somebody suggested we should put you on MTV, Brian.
Can we, yeah, I'd like to do that. It'd be a good time. Apparently the interest is there. They've reached out to me several times. So I just made a really, really bad mistake there, obviously by draining, but typically people don't put the second ball in danger. I should have left it there on the flipper. And there's the example of why I never, oh my goodness.
That's the, I think that was the typical trying to talk while you're trying to play mistake right there. So I don't think you need to feel too bad about that one.
I see Fred watching on, wondering if he's going to have to be the one to perform a feat of strength.
Yeah, they're all talking about your drop catches on the chat here. So
I guess that's a good thing.
Well, no, they're saying the space station is a great game to learn drop catches
on. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, you don't really have much of a choice.
Yeah, no, and that's, I think that's one of the reasons I was really drawn to this game. This is one of my favorite System 11s. That's true. It's one of my favorite System 11 games is because it's so, you know, I think it's just different. There's no way to really control the ball. And like you said earlier, it really forces you to play on the fly.
So at this point, your priority becomes trying to lock the ball in that left orbit and get back into multi-ball,
right.
Multi-ball ASAP.
Right.
So one thing I don't think we've talked about, or maybe you did, Brian, the little stand-up target all the way on the right, I believe right now it's on shuttle. It's hard to see.
Oh, yes.
And that changes the...
Yeah, that'll randomly change wherever this light is. It'll just cycle through until it stops somewhere.
Now, will that change both the station side and the shuttle side?
Just the station side. Because here, right under this target, it actually says change. And it's lit shuttle right now. The one right next to it says station. And then under that special. So
okay,
that
so right now anything. It's lit on shuttle. It would change the shuttle side.
Right,
and then
right.
When it's lit on station, it only changes the station side. And right. What was the third one down there on the playfield?
It says special.
Oh, okay.
Oh, this is actually turning out to be quite an intense game between you
he
two.
He wasn't lying about wasn't, being
I'm,
a...
I'm a ball three kind of guy.
He's a ball three guy.
Bo and Karen's taught me that. He also taught me how to slam tilt games in important situations. We've had a little feud going about that for a while now. So that was my chance to
you know, someday, Mark, we're going to have to get Bowen to do one of these shows with
yeah,
us.
Yeah, Bowen's got his $1,500 Monopoly dollars. He can bring them up anytime. I think he's going to be out, last I heard, in the middle of October. We're going to do a little filming, some more traditional style tutorials, and I think we're going to get him on this broadcast as well.
I think we're going to be able to do one or maybe two shows in October because of our trip to Expo. Mm-hmm. And... from what I understand, I don't think it's going to be smart for us to set up in between when we do the Expo and Orlando show. So,
yeah. Speaking of Expo...
What's that, Greg?
My name's Greg Galanter, and I like to play pinball. Does that count as my video?
That could be your video. You just send this whole thing to Josh Sharp,
it's
and he's
done.
Just going to get really mad at us.
Well, I already sent Josh something that said I won't be sending in a video, but I'm taking that back, and I just actually did my video, so we're all good.
Okay, so congratulations. Mark, do you want to do it too, just in case you decide to play this while we're out at Expo?
Yeah, this is my video.
Who are you?
I'm Mark Steinman. I used to eat bologna sandwiches with four slices and mustard. Well, you never said what it had to be about.
Did you say four slices of mustard?
No, four slices of bologna.
He
90,
did say four slices of mustard, I think.
90 calories a piece, and then a little bit of mustard on it.
Oh, I'm getting hungry. But not for that.
This game is turning out to be great. Fred is in trouble.
Fred's gonna crack again, like like he did on Centaur. It's all over.
He hasn't had much luck here on the broadcast recently. Brian is throwing down the gauntlet, though.
That's good because I'm looking forward to seeing what feats of strength the chat.
Yeah,
we're
gonna have to open up the broadcast next week with that to see if we can get him back into the competition. I'll put up a graphic as well to keep track of all of our scores.
Oh, that's great. I'm going to just stay at 1,500 the whole time.
I can't believe, Brian, you just fired off with the entire amount right away.
Go big or go home. That's the West Virginia way.
Well, he got Fred feeling comfortable, too, with those first two balls.
Maybe that was the idea. Maybe he's like, you know, he was just giving him a false sense of hope, and then he was going to crush his hopes and dreams on ball three.
Yeah, I mean, your state is shaped like a giant middle finger.
That's what I'm talking about.
Bowen, just to answer your question, yes, you are ranked within the top 250 in the world. You are allowed to take place in that tournament.
Actually, I haven't played competitively in so long, I'm not sure if I'm even in the top 250 anymore.
Well, you know, but at least we have you on video saying that you like bologna sandwiches, just so they know.
All right, what's the, where are we at here? Is he up about two? No, what, 1.5?
He just made like 3.6, so he's going to be up 1.5.
Plus, I had a whole bonus there, and I think I have a bonus ball here at the end of the game. Now, the bonus ball is pretty interesting because you can typically get up to 45 seconds of extra ball time after the game is over.
How do you light the bonus ball?
I'm sorry, I have two questions coming at once. So the bonus ball is lit. It's one of the awards there in the middle. So it's collected by finishing space or shuttle whenever it's lit on that. It's 50,000 points plus bonus ball.
Brian, step over to the left of the game so we can watch your expression whenever Fred crushes or falls apart under the pressure.
Absolutely. He's trying to post pass on a postless game.
That just happened.
You saw it here first. This is live TV where Fred Cochran might actually pretend that there's a post behind him.
The famous over and out.
Hey, while we're doing this, Mr. Glanner, I wanted to do my little question and answer thing with you.
Sure.
So why don't you go ahead and tell me what is your full name?
Gregory Max Galanter.
Max? Is it Maximus or is it just Max?
It can be. If you like Maximus, it can be Maximus. Well, but it's just Max.
Just Max. Yeah. All right, just Max. Greg, how old are you?
37.
Wow, you're
young.
He's
not a day over 25.
Put that man on. Oh, okay. No, let me just leave that there. Greg, what is your favorite pinball machine?
You know, I was worried you would ask me that. And I have a lot of pinball machines I call, my favorite depending on my mood. But my all-time favorite pinball machine is Bride of Pinbutt.
Really?
Really.
That's a wonderful game. John Trudeau game, right?
Indeed. And what I love about that game is the sound.
So what about the sound?
It makes me laugh. And when you get to the final multi-ball, when her face turns orange and the heartbeat starts, I'll start jumping up and down and bouncing around.
That game has a lot of quotable lines in it. So.
Hey, Greg.
Yes.
Whenever I was first getting into pinball, I remember watching you play Bride of Pinbot at Ron Schuster's house, and we were on the upper deck whenever Bride was up there. And, we had just hung out a couple times, and it was the first time I had ever seen Bride of Pinbot. And I remember watching you play this game and seeing you get fired up and listening to the heartbeat specifically. And that was one of the moments that got me into pinball, was watching you get excited about that game.
Well, that's amazing because here you are getting hundreds of people into pinball now. So
by extension, you pretty much created everything.
GMG is the creator of Papa.
Wow, that's news to me.
And me.
So, Greg, if you're in a pinball tournament, what would be your favorite machine to see?
Adam's Family.
Why is that?
It's just the game I feel that no matter how it's set up, I can get a hold of it. I've seen it set up where, you can barely control it out of the chair, or the swamp kick out. And I've seen it set up where you can just hold the flipper up and it's coming down and stopping. It really doesn't matter. It's a game that I just absolutely love. And it's one of the first games that I consider that I took to another level.
That's a great game.
This is going to be close.
What is your least favorite? Actually, hang on. Let's hold that question off a second here. Where are we at? This could be that. This is the end of Fred's. Okay, so Greg, we're gonna get back to you on this because we have to make Fred perform a feat of strength if he wishes to buy back into the Monopoly challenge.
A feat of strength.
A feat of strength. Mark, any ideas?
Yeah, I'm going to go with a full cartwheel. Just give me a...
No. I'm not even doing it.
It's a full cartwheel.
It's
that's
not worth it.
He couldn't say no.
My wife won't allow me to do it.
All right, you know, we're going to have to talk about this, and maybe we'll open up the show next time with his feet of...
Can you bench press CDs?
All right. Hold on.
Chris is running away down here.
Good thinking.
I'm going to cut away, see if we can get a camera angle for this.
Okay. So it's going to happen right now.
Yeah, I guess if we have this.
Yeah, I mean,
it's
a good time, you know. Look, this is the only way you're going to get to beat up on Chris, because you obviously aren't going to beat up on him playing pinball.
Absolutely not.
Well, this is your chance. This is absolutely going to happen. What could go wrong? Nothing at all could go wrong here.
My vote is still the power bomb through the game.
The
power bomb.
Nah, I'm saving the rights to that move. All right. So, just so you know, you saw it here on PAPAtv Pinball. This is officially us jumping the shark.
All right, make it happen, guys.
Make it happen. This is your feat of strength.
Chris, you got brought into this.
Who's spotting? Brian, are you spotting?
Come on.
Yeah, I'll be a good sport and I'll spot, I guess.
Okay, so.
I think you guys have to lower CDs onto Fred's outstretched arms.
I'm not really sure.
Nothing could go wrong here.
I'm speechless.
It's like the little kid. It's like the airplane game for kids.
There's no limbering up here. Make this happen.
Just
get on there.
Just get it done.
Ready?
One, two,
going
three.
First.
Oh my goodness, going down.
Ready? Down.
Put it down.
All right, let go. All right, he said let go. CDs, we learned today that CDs is ticklish today.
So we actually have a few minutes left. So if you guys want to do one more game on Space Station,
yeah.
that would be actually fine.
Hey, Fred, you want a rematch?
I don't know if we're going to be able to show the end of the game, but we have.
Let's take up the time we have. Go
yeah,
ahead,
we
guys.
Might as well go ahead. Just so you know that you saw it first here on PAPAtv.
So one thing we never discussed, does this mean that Fred gets a full 1500 back in?
Right. I'm going to say he earned that 1500, and I'm going to say that I'm looking at Chris's face right now. CDs is not happy.
I could have done it about seven more times. That was awesome.
Okay. So Greg, let me continue the interview that got so rudely interrupted.
Sorry, I had to do it.
I can't focus down here.
What was
amateurs?
What was the first pinball machine you remember playing, Greg?
I believe it was a Funhouse in a community center. But to be honest, it might have been a Hurricane. But I'm going to go with Funhouse because Rudy.
I remember the first time I saw Rudy. I was actually a little bit intimidated by it. You know, I was a little bit older than the age where you're, like, deadly scared of, the evil clown. But I still was a little intimidated by it. I just thought, I don't know. I also remember that I think my first game was actually Genie. I remember just hearing the noise coming from Genie. It's a very classic, and it's a noise all of its own.
I think you were asking me my least favorite machine to see in a tournament.
I'm assuming that by you reminding me of that, you have an answer for that question.
Well, because I saw it this year in PAPA.
What was it?
Twilight Zone.
Really? And why?
It has to be the game that I'm the absolute worst at. I heard that it was playing great. I heard that it was one of the few machines in A that people were really feeling comfortable on, and it still wasn't enough to get me to go over and play it.
Actually, that Twilight Zone was playing really nice, but you actually needed to get... I think you needed to get 500 million points on that. Chris, am I right on that?
I believe you are right, because I think on my ticket that I was able to qualify on, I think I put up around 600 or 700 and it didn't really give me that many points.
That's one of the downsides to having games that do play well in a tournament is whenever they play well, they're easy to blow up, and so your target scores just go up drastically. I know the high speed, I think it took, you know, 7-8 million or something just to get a respectable score.
So, Greg, why don't you go ahead and tell us something about yourself that I don't want to say nobody knows. Tell us something about yourself that most people wouldn't know that we're allowed to put on the on a live broadcast.
All these qualifiers.
actually, Greg, why don't you just say something?
I'm going to say stuff. What I'll tell you is that I moved to Hawaii in 2010. And, you know, I thought it was going to be the time of my life. And in many ways, it was. But the one way that it wasn't the time of my life is I went 3 years without playing a single game of pinball.
Did you, can I cut in? Did you go to, I was on my honeymoon in Hawaii, and I sought out a busted Jurassic Park in Waikiki at, like, an arcade in the top of the building. I don't know if you ever found this game or not, but I spent an entire day driving around the island in, like, paradise just looking for a pinball machine.
Exactly. No, I never found that game. I don't know if it was I just didn't know about it, but I did find a busted Rolling Stones.
So, what, Mick on a stick?
Yeah, but it didn't work. I mean, you could put money in, and indeed I did, but... one of the flippers was dead, and the play field looked terrible. So, I don't count that as a game in Hawaii. So, I stand by what I said earlier. I didn't play pinball for 3 years.
So, let me ask you this. You know, being that you were in one of the arguably most beautiful places on the earth, but you didn't have pinball, was it a fair trade?
Well, if it was just... the most beautiful place on earth versus not having pinball. That's still a tough question. I thought it was an easy one, but then it isn't. So,
it's pretty hard.
I missed it. And that's the truth. I did miss playing. And one of the, I'd say, 4 or 5 reasons that I wanted to come back was playing pinball with the people here in Pittsburgh.
Well, just so our audience knows, this is your one and only chance that we're going to force Greg to answer any question you put out there that I choose to read to him. There's a lot of qualifiers on what I'm saying tonight. I'm feeling very restrictive. So if you have any questions for Greg, please let me know, and we'll give him a chance to answer it live.
While people are typing in their questions... where can everyone go to watch the upcoming FSPA broadcast?
Okay, I can answer that, as a matter of fact. That is, you're just going to stay at Twitch TV, so it's www.twitch.tv/FSPA Pinball. That's Free State Pinball Association, FSPA Pinball. And they're going to be going live right around 8:30 here, so just in case you haven't gotten enough pinball with us tonight, you're going to get a little more. Wow, it looks like Fred's having to resort to some extraordinary tactics over there. In extraordinary situations, you have to use extraordinary means.
Any questions from the crowd, or are we going to go ahead and wrap this up?
No, I cannot bench press John.
Who makes that dapper shirt? Greg? I'm going to have to look in Greg's shirt here. That's Mitchell Kors. In case you... So, this is Papa TV style advice. This is now your section where you can find out the latest styles on men's pinball fashion. Only here can you find out the most sexy ways to...
All right, gentlemen, John, it's about time to wrap things up here from Papa. Like to thank everyone for tuning in tonight. Greg, thanks for sitting in the booth.
Thanks for having me.
And we look forward to seeing you guys again next week. So from all of us here at Papa, happy flipping and have a great week.